these ahkam, the rulings, is for a purpose, that it should be established. That is why you have rules in regards to, for example, state legal laws, where it should be implemented, such as qisas, so on and so forth. So therefore, it is a very important discussion that we find among the among these, you know, Shia and Sunni both schools, in regards to authority. How much authority does the imams have? How much authority does the scholars who are the representative of the imams have during the time of major occultation? First of all, the authority from the spiritual point of view, the spiritual authority, because many tend to believe only just in spiritual authority, but not in legal, for example. Then you have the legal authority of the imams. Then you also have the political authority of the imams. So the authority on all these three different levels. Now, within the within the development of the Shia or Islamic school, we find that those who tend to believe in the spiritual authority of the imam in the past, and some in the legal, some in the political, we have different sort of understanding. You know, there's the understanding of the ulama-i abrar, you know, that where in the course of history you find them. Then you have the Qum school, you know, then you have the school of Baghdad or the Ghullat, who existed initially. They also believed in the imam, you know, they also believed in the imam, and they also believed in some sort of authority that the imam have. Then you have people from the school of Baghdad. Then you have pure rationalists. What do they talk about the authority of the imams? Then you have Sheikh Tusi, Sheikh Mufid, the Ismailis, the Zaydis, for example. So we tend to find a lot of people, or a lot of individuals have discussed, institutions have discussed about the authority of the imams. Yes.
Go back to that slide.
Yes.
You know, this is the first time I've seen this. So I wanted to ask you, are you saying that those that are listed under, for example, ulama abrar, are those of the same kind of thought process, the mufassira, the Qum school, the pure rationalist? Are they generally in alignment with each other?
The source of their the thought that developed in regards to the authority, they take from them, you know. That is why you see the mainstream Shia, you have the Tusi and the Mufid, that we see that thought within among the Shia in regards to the authority of the imam.
So this spectrum you have drawn applies to each column?
Yes. The ulama-i abrar have their own understanding, which eventually later on, which was seen in the Qum school, or the Muqassira, or the pure rationalists. Now, this Qum school is not the school of today. I mean, this, like, we are talking about initiation of the Qum school and the Baghdad school and the Kufa.
What is ulama abrar and
yes, I mean, they were trends of followers of the imam, and they were named because of the type of belief that they had. For example, the Ghullat, they were the like extremists in terms of their belief in regards to the imam, to the extent of believing that the imam to be incarnation of God, and they have the authority in that sense of the word, you know.
So they all are considered Shia in some way, shape or form?
I mean, Ghullat, for example, then you will not consider them as Shia, because they believe they were raising the status of the imam to the extent that they being the incarnation, you know, there's a problem there. However, they believed in the imams, you know, they believed in the imams. But being a Shia or a Muslim might not be fit, you know, them. But in terms of believing in the authority of the imam, yes, you know, they have a role to play and their own sort of understanding and ideology in terms of what sort of authority does the Shia Imams have.
What about the Mufassirin?
It's the same way, you know, it has its own sort of trend and ideology and understanding, which they define that Imams have, you know, perhaps an authority which is, you know, limited, such as in terms of their spirituality, they are like political leaders, perhaps they might even make errors, but they do still have the authority, you know. Just like how some of them, they do not believe in the ismat, in the infallibility of the Prophet or the Prophets or the Imams, but they still, you know, believe in some sort of authority, you know, of the Imams. Yes.
So on that last slide, where you said the Gula were like the extremists, kind of, and like the Ulama of Grar, would they be like more leftist, and the mainstream would be like the moderate?
Yes, I mean that's why the Muqassirin also come in terms of the extreme left column. And, you know, the pure rationalist, you know, who just say, oh, okay, you know, he's also just like a man, you know, like every other man. There's nothing, you know, special about him. Because, and on the other hand, you know, it's not simple, as we are kind of like just mentioning that. They're based on sound arguments. They're based on the Quran. They're based on the Hadith. You know, for instance, they would say that, why Imam Ali mentioned in his will that, you know, I warn you of Shaitan to Imam Hassan, or, you know, you should not behave in this fashion, that fashion, you know, I seek forgiveness, for example. So that means that, you know, have they committed mistake, or Imam Ali committed mistake, that's why he's, you know, seeking forgiveness. So they have their own methodology of deriving their understanding of authority of the Imams, yes, which are rebuked, which are criticized, on the basis of the Quran, on the basis of akal and intellect and all that.
So their arguments are not well founded.
That is correct. Yes. Yeah. Now, as we might tend to classify them, like the 12 Shias, for example, you know, they were the ones, or the Ismailis as well, who believe in spiritual, legal, and even political authority of the Imams. You know, so the Ismailis tend to be very close to the 12 Shias' belief in regards to authority of the Imam. Then you have the Zaydis. You know, Zaydis, they just believe in the political authority of the Imam. That's it. Even they might not even go to the extent of spirituality as such, but in terms of the fiqh, in terms of the ahkam, they would rather follow the ahkam of the Ahle Sunnah. You know, they would, you know, follow that. But political authority, yes, they would say that Imam should be the leader. You know, Imam is the one who should lead. Once again, it is incomplete development of the thought. I mean, we have seen different patterns amongst the Islamic history, and they had their own set of beliefs, and because of their background, because of their lack of information they had, later on it was rectified, you know, they corrected themselves. So due to that reason, we find these differences occurring. For example, the Sufis, you know, they believe in complete authority, spiritual authority of the Imams. You know, they regard the Imams as the Qutub, you know, as the pole. You know, everything is from the Imams. But when it comes to the politics and fiqh, you know, they are like the Ahl-e Tasannun. You know, they say that, yes, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he has the spiritual wilayat, but the political wilayat really belong to the first Khalifa and the third Khalifa in the worldly plane. But in terms of the spiritual authority, yes, he is the Imam. You know, he governs everything in terms of spirituality. But on the worldly plane, on the dunyavi, you know, plane, perhaps it is possible that there be some other, you know, leader, you know, politically speaking. So, what happens after the 12 Imams, when they were there, the Shias, they believed in the Imams, the other, you know, they have the spiritual, political, legal authority. but because of certain directions from the Imam, you know, there weren't any uprising. For example, they came to the sixth Imam and asked, but Imam once again, you know, said, you know, it is not, there's no need to really emphasize or to really raise up arms to establish the political authority because of the circumstances that the Imams were. Yes.
One question I had about the Zaydis. I think they only believe in the infallibility of the first five Imams.
The four. Yes.
The four Imams. And they, my question is, I think one of their thoughts is, or beliefs is that had, like, to be Imam, they have to not only have akal but also revolt against the oppressed, the dictator. So my question was, had, I think it's Imam Al-Bakr, alayhi salam, had he
revolted? Yes, he would
have
been. Perhaps, yes, yes, it seems to be that way, yeah. Yes, the deputies, as we discussed on the first night, they were the sole authority appointed by the Imam himself in different ways, legal authority, spiritual authority, politically, which was out of the question in that sense of the word, that, you know, that they become political leader of the Islamic Ummah. So they, we had no issues. Yes, you have a question?
Could you please define the term Ismaili Zaydis and
Sufis? I think we will do it at the end of the, because Ismailis are those who believe still the sixth Imam, you know, to be in the nutshell. After that, they don't believe in the seventh Imam as we believe. So we are known as the 12ers. So we believe in the 12 Imams, the names of the 12 Imams, as we know, you know, from Imam Ali till the 12th Imam, Imam Hujjah. So therefore, we are called the 12ers. The Ismailis are called the six Imamis, as they believe Ismail, the son of our sixth Imam, to be the Imam, not the seventh Imam Musa Kazim of ours, to be the Imam after that. That's why they are known as the Ismailis. They believe in the Imamate of Ismail. Zaydis are the one who believed, you know, till the fourth Imam, Imam Zainul Abidin. After that, they, you know, they shifted. And the Sufis are, you know, they, you would find them to be mostly of having Sunni fiqh, or even you have certain Shias who have the Sufi tendencies. They are known, those who believe in the spirituality more. That, you know. Yes. So there was no crisis, as we said, during the time of the deputies. But right after that, we had issues in regards to, and that is the occultation. Now, within the Shia thought, you find in the very beginning the Naib, meaning the the deputies of the Imam, right? So that term was initially coined very naturally, you know. The deputy of the Imam is considered to be the Naib, you know, to be the deputy. And Naib, a khas, where the Imam have appointed. And then you have the issue of Naib Am, you know, the general deputy. Could be a scholar, could be, you know, a person who knows what is the will of the Imam to certain extent, and he execute, or he answers to the Imam, which considered to be the Naib or the deputy, who is a general deputy. Now, if we look at, if we start analyzing these terms, we find, for example, you know, one of the great scholar, Muhakkik al-Karaki, who discusses this in his book called Rasail, that the Imami Fuqaha have consensus, all of the, you know, they agree on this. I mean, it is very natural. I mean, there's no dispute, and it can't be, right? Because the Imam have appointed the Naib Khas, and then you have, you know, the, you know, Naib Am there. That a qualified faqih known as Mushtahid is the Naib, is a deputy of the infallible Imam alayhi salam in all the affairs. Hence, it is obligatory to refer to him in litigations and accept his verdict. Any issues happen, we go to the Naib-e-Am and we accept, he gives a verdict, whatever he say, we accept. If it were not for the wilaya, amma, general deputyship, there will be ta'til. You know, there will be, you know, things will be shut down. Nothing will happen. There will be no progress in terms of deen, in terms of religion. You know, issues are coming. There is zakat. There are, you know, affairs such as namaz of Eid, you know, qisas, so on and so forth. You know, all of these things will not really, you know, be continued. You know, one will not practice these things. So we have these two concepts now, which is the wilaya amma, the general, and the wilaya khassa. This wilaya amma and khassa, as we are discussing this in the, you know, from the reverse chronology, you know, we have the scholar Muhammad Hassan al-Najafi, where he writes in Jawahirul Kalam, which is one of the compendium of fiqh, that sanctioning Islamic sentences and implementing Islamic injunctions is obligatory. Obviously, when it is in the Quran, it is obligatory to carry out the ahkam, the rules that is there during the occultation. The jurists are the deputies of the imam in many aspects. The faqih's school social status is the same as the imam, and there is no difference between him and the imam in this respect. So this is, we are talking about, you know, 16th and 18th century, right? You know, it is not something that today somebody comes and say that, oh, there is wilayat-e mutlaq-e faqih, and they try to criticize. And, you know, this was discussed by, you know, by the previous scholars. You know, what is their authority and how far they could go may not be to that precise minute detail as we have of today, but in general, you know, it was overwhelmingly there was consensus, and the scholars accepted, you know, in regards to that. Yes.
Play devil's advocate here. Let's go back a couple of slides, if you don't mind. So the first time we're seeing this, that's like multiple authority. It's in 1530 AD.
We are going reverse chronology here.
Okay.
So, I mean, we're going to come eventually to the beginning, you know, when it really started. So this is like, you know, 1530 is sort of like, you know, latest kind of. You know, obviously, it developed from there, which we'll talk about later on. We will end up with Mufid, for example, which goes much more, you know, Yes.
By the deputies, did you mean like the deputies you talked to us about?
The four deputies of the imams, yes.
Right. And now that they're probably, I think they've all died right now, in the absence of them, who's the individual who kind of takes...
Right, it's the scholar. That's what we are, that's the you know, that's what the ulama and the scholars, the Shia scholars are talking about. That's what they are trying to establish, the authority of the imam. You know, this is like the occultation and the crisis in regards to the authority, what they should do, who are really the authority during the occultation. Then he continues that the verdict of our fuqaha is unanimous on this issue. Everybody agrees in their works, you know, different books of fiqh and jurisprudence. They frequently underscore the idea of referring to the hakim, who is the agent and the representative of the absent imam. If the fuqaha did not have the general niyaba, all the affairs of the Shia remained unattended. The same principle that if the fuqaha do not implement the you know, the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah, then the Shia affair will be attained will remain unattended. Those who surprisingly raise objections about the wilaya amma, so we have such thing called wilaya amma of the scholars, which is accepted unanimously. However, those who kind of criticize it of the faqih seem to be ignorant of, you know, usul al-fiqh, of jurisprudence, and the words of the infallible imams. They have not pondered these words and their meaning. You know, this is what the Aghai Isfahani mentions. Now, As we move on, you know, there are more examples being provided, and if one kind of pay attention to is now we are talking about Shahid Awwal, which is once again where the Muhakkak Karaki was 1530 and now we are to 1384, you know, which is once again much more it's more of scholars who were previous to Muhakkak Karaki.
You mentioned the term vilayam. It's understandable for those of us who are a little bit familiar with the Arabic term. And I know you mentioned it, but can you define that?
Vilaya means authority, you know, an authority to dictate the religious rule or the religious answer, you know, in relation to the issues the Shias or the Muslims face. You know, that they have that authority, you know, they have that wilaya. Amma is in general authority, which means that the scholars in general who are knowledgeable and who are mujtahid, you know, they have the ability to extract and deliver the verdict or the wish and the will of the imam. Now we are not looking at, you know, who qualifies to be a mujtahid, what if there are difference of opinion, there are two mujtahid, can there be two wills of the imam? No. I mean, in the general sense, you know, that's what it means. Now, Shahid Awwal also talks about the issue of zakat. You know, it is, as we read, it said that it is obligatory to give zakat to the faqih, to the jurist, during the occultation, if he asks for it himself or through his agent. For he is the deputy of the imam, once again that deputy of the imam. You know, this term is been seen over and over again. Just as the tax collector, rather it is more appropriate to state that their vicegerency on behalf of the imam is applicable in all those matters in which the imam himself has authority. You know, whereas the tax collector is the agent of the imam only in the particular functions. He just goes and he collects tax for that particular one hukum of zakat. But however, you know, the scholars, they are as if, you know, they themselves in all matters have that authority during the time of, you know, occultation. You know, during the time of occultation. Now Mufid, you know, which we go about another, you know, 100 years behind, where, you know, clearly one of the founder of Usuli thought, you know, and this is much closer to the occultation period, much closer to the deputies, you know, those naibs who were there, you know, which is once again points out to that authenticity of this thought of wilaya amongst the Shia school. It could, however, be established that the concept is much older than these fuqaha and goes back right to the founding father of Shia jurisprudence, Sheikh Mufid, of the view that the application of legal punishment, hudud, was the key function of a faqih. He is responsible to carry that out. You know, and even if you look at, for example, during the Safavid period as well, as the Safavid dynasty was the first Shia dynasty, there were scholars within this whole you know, system of governance who carried out the hudud. You know, the law was an Islamic law and they carried that out. Once again, due to certain issues, perhaps the scholars did not express the sole political authority, you know, in terms of being with the, you know, being the king of the dynasty to be a jurist, but they were next to jurists, they were ministers, they were advisors, and as they say that Shah Abbas-e Awwal, he himself was a scholar in full right, you know, and then we find others or other dynasty as well where we find they were themselves were mujtahid, like for example the Quli Qutub Shahi dynasty in these in the south of India, we find that they were mujtahid and scholars, and Muhammad Quli Qutub Shahi himself was trained by Mir Momin Astarabadi, you know, who migrated from Najaf to Hyderabad, and he established the Quli Qutb Shahi dynasty there. Now, on what basis the authority is based on? You know, where do they extract this wilaya from? You know, what are the basis of that? For example, the laws that are mentioned in the Quran, and these laws which are mentioned in the Quran are, individualistic approach, or laws that are approached on the communal level, such as, for example, you know, penal code, such as family law. You know, all of these things are to be implemented. You know, all of these things requires an authority for it to implement. Then you have the law of inheritance, if one, and these are things occur. You know, it's not like a small group of 50-60 families living in Atlanta. We are talking about the whole state. We are talking about millions of Shia population living in Iraq, in Iran, in Afghanistan, in all of these places. And what if a person dies and he hasn't really provided that will? Who is supposed to implement and give the right to the children, for example? Or if he has no children, who takes that things that he has left behind? Now, the question which arises here is the extent of the authority that the fuqaha might have. As we mentioned earlier, the laws within the Quran, there's this individualistic approach, the communal approach as well. Now, the second thing that is quite important to look at it is that the laws that are mentioned there, are they contextual or universal? Is it universal or contextual? How far is the parameters of these laws, and how far it could be implemented, purely on the individual level or on the universal level as well? Now, we have an issue here. Now, if we say that yes, these laws are to govern the society, these laws that are there, the problem occurs is in regards to the change of the society, because the Sharia is something that is fixed. The Quran and Sunnah is fixed. It cannot be changed, isn't it? But we have the society which is ever changing. Things change in the society. Now, what's going to happen is, once again, as the authority of the Imam, and then we say the authority of the scholars, who are the Naib, who are the deputies, they base their reasoning on the Quran, on the Sharia, and Sharia is something that is fixed and irrevocable and unchangeable. I mean, for us today, as we have gone through that process, it is something very easily for us to digest. But people living in during that period, right, it was something new to them altogether. Now, what will happen? All of a sudden, some new invention of sound system. Is it jais, not jais? It is, are we supposed to use it because it wasn't there during the prime time of the Prophet? Vehicles, motors, cars, can we really use them or not use them? There was a major debate and discussion in these regards. But we take these things for granted. Those people who were religious, like, for example, now, we consider ourselves to be religious, and these are the special nights, and we are making an effort to come here. Is it really necessary that we come here or not necessary? Is it still, if a person who doesn't come here, can he be called a Muslim or not a Muslim? Things like that, right? So these are simple things, but we are talking about inventions. We are talking about, implementation of the Sharia for people who are religious. We might have, 200 families here. Out of 200, maybe only 50 families are religious, but we are talking about nations, right? And the representation of the Sharia and Ahkam and Quran, which lies in the hands of the scholars. So they have to really, you know, there were political movements, you know, people were asking, revolutions and all that, right? So here, when we look at it, when we want to apply Sharia, especially to an ever-changing social structure, as Shahid Mutahiri points out, that we have these two issues coming up. So how could an Islamic system claim that it can remain Islamic and at the same time keep pace with the social change? It has to be Islamic, you know, and at the same time it is in accordance to the changes that is taking place. Any questions or anything that you want to add, maybe? Yes, Bismillah. Okay, we'll come at the end, inshallah. Yeah. Okay. Now, the answer, or what we find, is that either it has to go beyond the boundaries of the Sharia, you know, for a faqih to go really, in a way, from his own sort of, you know, opinion, you know, he has to answer. And he has to leave the Sharia and give an answer, or he needs to make sure that the necessary changes are made only outside the realm of Sharia, or extend the Sharia to the question or the problem or the issues that one is facing. Now, it remained a question. You know, what should be the way forward? And in the contemporary era, one would say perhaps Naini was the one who executed or who came up with the theory that the jurist, for example, have that authority to really extend the Sharia to the to expand the Sharia. You know, but it was still, you know, in the beginning stages. But Naini is considered to be the kind of like the founder of this political thought of what we have today, which we call the governance of faqih. The first option is usually backed by the modernist and certainly not by the jurist, and that is deserting completely the Sharia. We have, you know, this is for that period. We are modern, and we don't really have to consider the ahkam for this period. As the society is developing, so the ahkam can only be applied in the limited sense, perhaps for salat, perhaps for hajj. But even, you know, as we develop more, even perhaps the ahkam of hajj might change as well, you know, according to those who are modernist. Then you have once again, the jurist, the first Shia jurist who thought and wrote about this problem, as we said, it was Shaykh Naini in the book called Tanbih al-Ummah wa Tanzih al-Millah. I mean, the word Millah itself, one would say that it's a new term being coined there, where it's more political, and he kind of pointed out to, and it was at the same time having at a very crucial time. Within Iran, and that is the constitution revolution, you know, that was taking place. People were really questioning legally, you know. You have a batch of ulama scholars really supporting the constitution revolution. We have a batch of ulama who were against it, to the extent that you find the martyrdom of Sheikh Nuri taking place as well. So anyways, it was, you know, the ulama. One thing that we need to know is that the scholars have always been parallel to the political system and the governance, whether that be Shia dynasty, you know, kings or rulers, or that be a political sort of secular leaders within that area, you know, from the very beginning. They've been part and parcel of the dynasties And this eventually led the scholars to be actively involved even when these dynasties collapse, when these, the system of, of governance, the methodology of governance started to sort of crumble and change into form of political system or secular system. So once again, you have scholars expressing their opinion, criticizing the occupation of the West, criticizing the secular system very openly. It was the scholars who did that, Yes.
So was Allama Sayyid Muhammad Hussein al-Naimi, was that during the period of the Qajar dynasty in Iran?
Yes. Yes, that is end of the Qajar, we are looking at, the Constitution Revolution, where more of a, secular sort of system wants to come in place.
What's meant by second option there for reminder? So you say the second option is supported by...
Which is the, if you go back, it's the, Sharia should be... that there should be a change in the system outside the Sharia. If we want to bring in laws from the West, secular laws from the West, we should make sure that they fit within the context of the Sharia. If you want a governance, if you want a parliament to be there, if you want a political system to be there, somehow this should really come under the libas, under the terminologies of the Sharia. So it's not once again which we see, a thought where you can expand, the parameters of the Sharia. Why not? Instead of constricting the modern thought give the dress of Sharia to the modern thought, or somehow make that it fits with the Sharia belief system, rather than making the Sharia so vast where it contains that sort of research or development as we tend to find today. That's the third one. So he was under the opinion of that, yes, there is a political leadership of the Sharia, but of that second option. The wilaya, the authority is of the scholars, and they are responsible to make sure that the development of the secular thought or political system or religious social system somehow befit the Sharia rules. Yes. Instead of leaving it completely. No, it doesn't. So the modernist, where they say that we have to leave, yes.
Is that second option kind of like how in the Kingdom of Morocco, the people, I guess, that are trying to put forth laws, they kind of try to conform that to the Sharia?
In Morocco, I'm not too sure. I'm not too sure. Okay. Now, in terms of Sheikh, he argues that the first type of laws of Sharia that cannot be violated, and the second type are the spatial or temporal based laws, which are left to the discretion of the Islamic government and could be legislated by the parliament. So Naini was of the opinion that there are certain laws we just can't really budge, or we can't really change at all. It's very strict. The codes are very strict. But there are certain laws which perhaps could be changed. For him, for instance, the policies measured assumed due to the Siyasat al-Nawiyya, which is the expediency and urged by social change, fall into the second category. So whatever social change is taking place is within the jurisdiction of the scholar. If there be any social change, whether that be a modern system of democracy be established, but still as we do not have a certain law to govern this modern system of parliament or policy, we would allow them to happen. However, it will be within the jurisdiction of the Wali Amr, as long as it doesn't go against the laws which are, you know, which cannot be violated, you know, which doesn't go against the principles and those laws which are, maybe, for example, if someone wants to have a system that is based on riba, you know, which Islam is against, right?